Hello, everyone. Hope you guys are enjoying your Tuesday. as if anyone really cares that it's Tuesday. Anyway, today I want to do a video that is really going to be a pontification on the past, the recent past, that is, and how time isn't just really, really fast, but how things change so much, so quickly, over a relatively short amount of time. I was thinking about this today as I was delving into horror movies. I was thinking about horror movies today, and the reason why I'm thinking about horror movies is because I have been playing Resident Evil 8. I recently got Resident Evil 8, finally got it. It came out in May, and I must say, so far, it is quite a good game. It's like you're in a horror movie. It's like you're in a movie. For those of you who don't know, Resident Evil is a very old video game universe. It's been here since the late 1990s, and every few years or so, Capcom, the Japanese company that created Resident Evil, will put out a new Resident Evil game. And sometimes you'll get more games than that within a short amount of time. Sometimes you'll get a shorter Resident Evil game in the next year or whatever. The game is about really fighting zombies, right? But it's more than that. It's not just about zombies. It's also about this giant pharmaceutical company called Umbrella. And Umbrella is superficially a pharmaceutical company that makes medicine, and they're there to help people, right? They are in society to help people with medicine. But on the side, they are creating bioweapons. They're designing viruses. They are engineering viruses to make people into zombies so that these zombies could then be used as weapons, as bioweapons. And some of these zombies are easy to kill. You hit them with a few bullets and they're down. But some of these zombies, like the Nemesis, are absolutely nightmarish, and they take a hell of a lot of bullets to take out. And so when you first start playing the game, you just see the zombies. And you're thinking, wow, okay, the game is about fighting zombies. But then as the story unwraps itself, as it all fleshes itself out, you'll start seeing that the that this big corporation was the one behind this nightmare. You'll see the little logo for Umbrella, which is really an umbrella, plastered on a poster or plastered on a wall. And you'll notice that this has all of the marks of this big corporation. That this is really what essentially Resident Evil is about. The game gives you this concept of looking at the zombies, being terrified by them, but then realizing that they are really not the most dangerous thing in this video game. That the most dangerous thing is people who are very powerful, people who have lots of money, who can pull the strings and can really wreak tremendous amounts of havoc. Like, a mob is destructive. A human mob is destructive. Absolutely. But what is more dangerous than the mob is the powerful group of people who are funding the spread of the ideology or the propaganda that stokes up the mob, that incites the mob, that cultivates this growing, longing aspiration for blood that really sparks the formation of a mob, because a mob wants blood. So you look at a mob and you see a bunch of people with pitchforks and you think, oh my gosh, this is the worst thing ever. And it is. I mean, at that moment, it is the worst thing ever. I mean, you better get the hell out of Dodge or else you're going to end up with a pitchfork inside of you. But ultimately, in the bigger picture, the most dangerous thing is the group of people who are funding the spread of the propaganda that incites the mob. It reminds me of a book that I read a number of years ago. This was back in 2018. I read a book called Memoirs on the History of Jacobinism by a French Jesuit scholar named Augustin Barruel. And if you have not read that book, I recommend that you do. If you are a fan of reading about the French Revolution or really reading about the occult, and even if you are, let's say, a horror fan, but you want to see the reality of horror in human history, this is a good book for you to read, because Barruel doesn't just conjoin history in a book. What he does is he conjoins history and the ideology that incited this horrific event in history within this book. It's really well done. Sometimes it gets a little bit lagging, but most of the time, Barruel's book is very fascinating. It gets into really intricate details on what this ideology was. What was the dark side of the Enlightenment? And this is something that is rarely ever talked about. But anyway, going back to video games and horror, Resident Evil is a really good, fun video game universe. And by fun, I mean it's intense, it's exciting. It's a game, when you play it, you know, be it Resident Evil 4 or be it Resident Evil 2, Resident Evil 3, whatever, when you play Resident Evil, it does a good job of making you feel kind of desperate. Like, you're stuck in this building and these zombies are coming after you and you have a limited amount of ammo and you have to make sure that you're aiming right. You don't want to waste any ammo whatsoever. I just saw a chicken literally fly on top of a chair and the chair toppled over. My God. Anyway, the things that happen when I record a video, as soon as I start recording a video, it's like all the animals decide to come alive. Anyway, so I was thinking about it, and I was first introduced to Resident Evil in the late 1990s. Okay, I was around maybe 8 or 9 years old, and I remember I was visiting my uncle's house, one of my uncles, the home of one of my uncles. I have numerous uncles, and he had this little PlayStation PS1 sitting there, and at that time, I had never played a video game. I never had a console. I think I played video games a few times, but it was like at Kmart when they had the N64 or the PlayStation for you to play, but they said, you know, don't go past 5 minutes or something like that. Hello, cat. But at that time, I had no video games. Didn't have a PlayStation. I don't think I even had a Game Boy Color at that time. No video games, because my parents were like, it's too expensive. It's a waste of money. So I really wanted a video game console. I hated the feeling of when I was in school and I would hear other kids talking about their video games. And I was stuck with, I don't know, little action figures and water guns. So I went to this home of my uncle's, and he had this little PlayStation sitting there. And I said, oh, I really want to play. Oh, you know, I never had a video game console before. So he said, oh, you want to play? Okay, fine. So he had this little stack of video games, I remember. I have a cat that is meowing. Anyway, he had this little stack of video games, and one of them was Resident Evil. And I'm pretty sure this was the first Resident Evil game. And I said, oh, what's this game? What's this game? And he said, oh, you don't want to play that one. That one's going to scare you, and your mom will be very upset with me if she ever found out that I allowed you to play this. And, you know, don't want to play this game. It's really violent and horrifying. So in my mind, I'm like, oh my gosh, what's in this game? It's so horrifying that he won't even allow me to play it. Like, what's in this game? And it really just sparked my curiosity. But we ended up playing, like, Die Hard, the video game that was based off of the film with Bruce Willis. Anyway, and that game was violent enough. Good grief. Actually, that game was probably way more violent than Resident Evil. Can't kill zombies, but you sure as hell can kill, like, German terrorists in a bathroom in a big, giant building owned by some Japanese company. Anyway, so that was my first introduction to Resident Evil, even though I didn't even play it. Anyway, I didn't really care so much about Resident Evil. Years later, I was like, okay, heard about it, didn't really care for it. I was much more interested in playing like World War II games. That was the genre that really fascinated me, was games based off of World War II, like Medal of Honor or the first Call of Duty games. And I really enjoyed those games because I was really into history. I mean, I was fascinated by history, fascinated by geography, and I was also fascinated by ideology. And so fighting Nazis was always something that really got my attention. And yeah, the first console I got was N64, but no World War II games were made for N64, not that I know of. But then I got GameCube years later, and that one had some great World War II games. But then one day I was in the in this giant electronics store in California. It's called Fry's. I'm pretty sure it's still there. And anyway, I was in the store and they had this giant screen up there and they were playing different trailers for different video games. And they played this trailer for the new Resident Evil game at that time. And this was in 2004, I'm pretty certain. I was 13 or 14 years old at the time. And before seeing this trailer, I had no interest in playing Resident Evil. But then the trailer pops up, and they have the trailer for Resident Evil 4, the fourth installment to the series. And they show you this guy with a machine gun, and he's not just fighting zombies. He's fighting people dressed up in long robes, look like they're in a member of a cult. And I'm like, I gotta get this game. All right. And they got rock and roll music playing in the background. And I thought, man, I really gotta get this game. So I got the game, Resident Evil 4, and I couldn't stop playing it. And really fell in love with the game. It's very long. And Resident Evil 4 is definitely one of the most revolutionary video games ever created. If you actually look at it, I mean, there was no game like it before its creation, before its publication. And the game was very original in its style. It was the first game to utilize an over-the-shoulder perspective. So before Resident Evil 4, you had games that were in the third person, but they were like pretty far away. You know, if you look at games like Banjo-Kazooie, or if you look at the earlier Resident Evil games, the characters are pretty far away, and it kind of makes you feel it kind of makes you feel quite insecure when you're playing the earlier Resident Evil games and different camera angles, and it was actually quite monotonous and nauseating, really. But if you look at a lot of the earlier games, Banjo-Kazooie for N64, the characters were far away from the screen. But then you look at first-person shooters like GoldenEye or World's Not Enough, and they were first-person shooters. You saw the hand, you saw the gun, and it made you feel like you were in the story. But Resident Evil 4 utilized kind of a mix between third-person and first-person in the sense that you're looking right over the shoulder of your character, and so you're looking at your character almost like this, and it was really, really cool. And you had, you were just controlling this character, and you felt like you had a lot more control over him just from the perspective that you were looking at the story from. And I couldn't stop playing the game. And one thing that just really got me about this game, the reason that there was numerous reasons why I loved the game. The graphics were great. The music was creepy. It was atmospheric. It was very intense, and it was very long. I mean, Resident Evil 4 is by far the longest Resident Evil game in the whole series. It took two discs to play this game, two GameCube discs to play this game. It was so long. And because I wasn't playing video games every day, it took me months to finish it. But the reason that really brought it all together for me was its subject matter. In Resident Evil 4, you fight a cult. You don't fight just zombies. You fight intelligent zombies who are a part of a cult. And they are a part of a cult called Los Iluminados, which is Spanish for the Illuminated Ones. And you are in rural Spain and you're fighting a cult. And you go into this village and all the villagers look horrifying. They speak in this very vulgar way of speaking. They speak to you in Spanish, so it's like you're really there. There's no subtitles. If you don't speak Spanish, you don't know what the hell they're saying. And all of a sudden, Dr. Salvador pops up, and he has a chainsaw. And all of a sudden, from a distance, you can hear... It's horrifying. It really is horrifying. But it was like you were fighting a cult. And at that time, I was really into reading about different cults. I was reading a lot about Islam at that time. But I was also reading about gangs and kind of looking into evil ideologies at that time. This was like when I first began to look into ideologies and destructive ideologies. And I was interested in the left and the liberals and fighting the liberals. And again, you know, you have to understand, I grew up listening to Michael Savage. I grew up watching Bill O'Reilly. I grew up watching Hannity and Combs. And of course, I was always rooting for Hannity. Now I look back and I'm like, well, Combs was actually right on a lot of things. Combs passed away a number of years ago. Alan Combs, he was a famous news broadcaster back in the day. But I actually had not too long before he died, maybe like months before he died, I spoke with him because he wanted to bring me on for a debate. And it was like a 15, 20 minute long debate. It was a lot of fun too. But before we debated, I remember Alan and I were talking and I said, oh, Alan, I remember watching you when I was like in junior high. When I was like 12, 13, 14 years old, I remember watching you arguing with Hannity. And I told him, I said, you know, you guys would argue about the Iraq war. And I said, Combs, you were right. And Hannity was wrong about the Iraq war. And Combs said, yeah, but Hannity would never agree with some of the things that you say, Theodore. Anyway. But I grew up in that environment and I really kind of sucked it all in. But I liked the idea of fighting a cult. That's one thing that I loved about the game. So anyway, I thought, wow, Resident Evil 4 is such a great game. I wonder how the earlier Resident Evil games look like, because I hadn't really looked at them at all, actually. So then I went to this friend's house, and he had this, he had a little PS, that was old PlayStation system, looked like a PS1. And he had, I want to say he had Resident Evil 2 on there. And I said, oh, let me play. Because I'm thinking, wow, Resident Evil 4 is so good. I wonder how Resident Evil 3 looked like, or Resident Evil 2. So we pop the game in and we start playing. And it was like pixely, camera, different camera angles popping up really, really quickly, nonstop. The camera angles don't stop changing. It's in this bizarre third-person shooter perspective where your character's really far away. It was just nauseating and it wasn't scary. And all the zombies are like this. Compare that to Resident Evil 4, where the zombies are speaking to you in Spanish and they're planning on how to kill you and they're communicating amongst themselves. And as soon as they see you, one of them will point a finger at you and he'll say something like, "Te voy a matar." It is horrifying. It's disturbing. But you look at the earlier Resident Evils and you're like, that's not scary at all. But you have these puritanical people who will say, oh, bring back the old style, bring back the old style. And I'm looking at the old style and I see a bunch of pixels. It just doesn't look interesting to me. At that time, it was interesting. In the late 90s, it was scary. I mean, it was scary enough for my uncle to say, yeah, I don't want you playing that game. Your mom will be really upset with me. But if you look at it now, you're like, that's not scary at all. But it makes me think about my grandmother and her reaction to horror movies. Like when I'll never do this, but if I had my grandmother, who's still alive, who was born in the 1930s. My grandmother was alive when Hitler was walking the earth, okay? My grandmother was alive when Hitler was ruling over Germany. And I know that's, like, not very unique because there's still a bunch of people who are alive today who were alive when Hitler was ruling over Germany. But, I mean, again, we have to remember that that generation is being eclipsed and we better cherish it now because soon these... living historical relics, and I don't say that in a derogatory way. I say that in a positive way. These walking living archives from the past, I should say, they're not going to be here in a certain amount of time. And so we better cherish it and learn as much as we can from them. But if I played The Conjuring to my grandmother, right? The first Conjuring film, which was really the one I think is the best, and I think most people would agree with me, she would utterly freak out. Like, she would not be able to handle it. If she saw, like, and it, for those of you who don't know, The Conjuring is another horror universe, but it's not a video game. It's a film universe. And when you watch the first Conjuring movie, there are some scenes in that film that are creepy. I mean, and there's a scene where there's a woman who's possessed, and her mouth is all bloody and looks disturbing, and she looks at the guy in the film and she goes, "Your whole family's about to die." And you know, there's something about it that's very unsettling, but she would utterly freak out. I would look at it and be like, "Oh, that's creepy," and whatever, but I wouldn't lose any sleep over it. But if I showed it to my grandmother, she would be like, "Oh my God, what is this demonic stuff?" But we have to remember that my grandmother grew up in a time when horror movies were literally people like covered in toilet paper pretending to be mummies. I'm not even exaggerating this. Like, if you look at the earlier horror films, when my grandmother was a teenager, it was like a mummy covered in toilet paper with his hands out like this, the stereotypical mummy form. And people in the theater were like, "Oh my goodness." And I'm like, wait, this was the generation that saw Normandy Beach. This was the generation that saw the horrors of the Third Reich, and this horrifies them. Like, whatever. But again, that was at a time when horror, the genre of horror, was still brand new, and so people just weren't used to any horror. So those people weren't really making horror movies like we are today, and so they thought, okay, what's going to scare people? And they didn't really have to think that much because the idea was still very non-existent in to a great extent. There were some silent films that were, you know, silent horror movies in those days, but still, I don't think the business of horror films was nowhere near what it is now. But then, you know, The Conjuring came out at a time, it was like in the early 2010s, and it was coming at a time when that genre was very new, and I think what commenced that genre was The Conjuring. I guess some people could argue that The Grudge was an early example of this style of filming, but The Grudge wasn't. I mean, that's a boring-ass movie. But The Conjuring really, really started like a whole new concept of horror film directing. So then The Conjuring 2 came out, and you're like, okay, that's okay. And you had Annabelle, which was kind of disappointing, and then you had Annabelle 2, which was okay. You had Ouija Board 2, and these films were okay. The first Conjuring film was great. What made the first Conjuring scary was its suspense, the way that it surprised people, the way that it ambushed the audience. You know, she walks down the stairs and all of a sudden you hear a and the lights go off and it just freaks people out. But the scene that really, really was iconic in the first Conjuring film was the scene where the little girl was in the room and she couldn't get out because the demons locked the door, and she sees a woman on a rocking chair and there's a doll on the woman's lap. And we don't know who this woman is. We can't even see her face. And all of a sudden, the doll just turns and looks at her. And there's something about it that's so horrifying. But it reminds me of something that I actually experienced myself firsthand. I'll tell you the story. This is a horror story from the life of Theodore here. When I, honest to God, when I think about this time, this event that took place in my life, I still get chills. I'm not even gonna lie. I still get chills. And as I'm going to tell you this, as I'm going to tell you guys the story, as I'm going to recount to you guys the story, I'm going to feel chills as I'm telling it. So I used to live in Mexico. I was born and raised in the Bay Area in California. But at the age of 14, I went to, was it 14 or, yeah, at the age of 14, I went to Mexico. And I lived in Mexico for over a year. And I lived literally walking distance from a beach. It was awesome. I used to swim in the ocean almost every single day. Not even going to exaggerate. Almost every day I was in the beach. And it was so awesome to live there because you could just walk to the beach and you could live kind of like in a dream. I mean, you saw some little Mexican guy with a big pile of coconuts next to him. You paid him a couple pesos and he'd crack open a coconut for you, stick a straw in it and give it to you. I mean, it was magical. There was something so magical about it. Except for that one time that I got stung by a jellyfish. But anyway, I used to go to the beach all the time. And there was this, I lived in this town. It was called Puerto Vallarta, very popular tourist site. A lot of Americans like to live there. A lot of Canadians and British people like to live there. Maybe once in a while you'll spot an Australian. But Canadians and Americans, they were the the predominant foreigners who were settling in this place. And there was this area of the town. It was called Viejo Vallarta, which literally means Old Vallarta. And it was basically the original town of Vallarta. Like, everything outside of it is kind of an extension or a later extension to Viejo Vallarta. But Viejo Vallarta was, like, that was the original part of the town. And you knew that it was old because you would see a lot of cobblestone. You would see some kind of like old buildings would be there. It was nice. It looked very kind of retro, I guess. I don't know. But there was the reason why I wasn't always too comfortable going to Viejo Vallarta. It had a really nice beach, which was the main reason why I liked going there. But it wasn't always the funnest place because due to the influx of Americans and Canadians, you know, there were a lot of weirdos there. And I remember one time I walked to the beach. I used to walk to the beach because I lived pretty close to it, maybe like a 10-minute, 15-minute walk. And one day I walked to the beach, and there was this block that you had to go through. It was this little neighborhood that you walked through, and you would see these little homes that were all just attached to each other, and each one had a window, so you could, if the windows are open, you could see in through the window. So went to the beach and got, after like maybe an hour or two of swimming and just relaxing, I started to leave the beach, and I went, started heading back home, and I walked through this block. I walked down this block, and I passed by this little house, and the window of this house was wide open. It was open. There was no screen window or anything like that. It was an open window, and I saw this guy reading a book. And it looked like this. And I could just see him like this. And you just see the side of his head. And I looked at him. And he would look at me like this. He would go. And it scared the hell out of me. Yeah, scared the hell out of me. So I kept walking. And so the next day I went to the beach, walked through the same thing, and the same thing happened. The guy's reading a book. And he does the Annabelle head twist. And the third time I went, and I don't know if it was exactly the same day after this one, but the third time I went through that area and he was there, he did the same thing, and it was horrifying. And the guy, I'm pretty certain this guy was a predator. And I never went through that area ever again, actually. It just horrified me and gives me chills to this day. So, you know, when I see the Annabelle scene, that's what it reminds me of. But anyway, The Conjuring came out. First Conjuring was great. Second Conjuring was okay. And then, like, they just came out with a recent one. And I literally, after 20 minutes, I turned the film off. Because the film was so corny and so saturated with the same old stuff. I said, come on, they have to be more original than this. But, you know, something happened in the 20-teens that really revolutionized filmmaking. So you had The Conjuring, and then later Conjurings are okay, but the first one was really original. But something happened in 2015 that really, I think, revolutionized horror film directing, and that was The Witch. The Witch was a film that came out in 2015, and it was really well done. And it's about this little Puritan family that lives in the middle of nowhere in colonial America. And the film was very well directed. It's all there, and all the characters are speaking in this really old dialect of English that sometimes it's so difficult to understand that they had to put subtitles for this movie. And they're speaking in some dialect that was spoken in Essex, England, in the 17th century, I believe. For example, there's a scene where a girl addresses her mother, and she says, "Mother!" It's a way of speaking English that no one speaks anymore, unless you go to, like, certain areas of England, maybe. But that film was really well done. Why? It was atmospheric. And there was not really much happening in this film. It's about this family that's in the middle of nowhere and they're slowly breaking apart, breaking down, and the daughter gets seduced by this witch cult in the middle of the woods. It's a fascinating, it's done in a very fascinating style. It's very atmospheric. The music is very haunting, but it just pulls you into the story. Why? Even though there's not much happening, there's something about the way that the film is directed that pulls you in. It's quiet, atmospheric. There's a lot of ambience in the movie, and it's done so well. It's done in such a crisp way that it just pulls you in. And that film was very revolutionary, and other directors began to sort of copy that style. You had, for example, The Black Coat's Daughter in 2017, which was also a really well-done film, I think better than The Witch. Numerous films that have been made in this style. But you look at time, and this is the theme of this video, you look at time, and as it goes by, things change. And I know that sounds really cliche, but it is kind of surreal to experience it. When you're a little kid, you know, time feels like it's forever. Like, for example, I remember as a little kid, December would come, and they would say, oh, Christmas is coming. And the time that it took to finally get to Christmas, December 25th, really felt like forever. It felt like forever, like you were waiting months. But it really was just a few weeks that you were waiting. But at that time, it felt like a really long time, a really long time, and a dreadfully long time, I should say. But now it's like it feels like it was just last night that October began, and now we're about to finish October and we're about to hit November. It's like, my goodness gracious, pretty soon we're going to be in December. As you get older, time feels faster. It really does. It just feels faster. I was talking to this girl about this a few years ago. She was from Spain, and she was older than me, actually. She was maybe like 30. At that time, she was like 36, and I was still 29. And I said, you know, time just keeps, like, every year it gets faster. And she says, wait until you're 36. It feels faster. And as time goes by in this super fast, almost surreal way, it's like things are changing so quickly. You look at the style of films and how they have changed. And every 10 years, the world changes dramatically. Like, it changes drastically. Really, really, you feel this dramatic shift every decade. The music changes, new styles of film get introduced. And again, albeit these are built on styles that existed before, but still, as the years go by within the next decade, these new styles feel even more new as they take upon a shape of their own, and they become more original. But every 5 years, every half decade, the world will change. But every 10 years, it changes even more. And I would say that when you hit the fifth year of a decade, you really get an idea of what's in store for the next decade. So every 5 years, you feel you get a sense, you get a sample of what's in store for the next decade. I remember in 2015, I mean, like, 2015 feels different from now. But when I was in 2015, the world felt a lot more different than 2010. So every half decade, you get these incremental changes. You reach these new levels of change. It's like reaching a new level in a video game, or reaching a new chapter in a book, or entering a next section within a film. You feel it, and sometimes it hits you really hard. Like in 2015, I remember, it was like, all of a sudden, gay marriage became constitutionalized. All of a sudden, that whole agenda became so intensified in 2015, I remember, so intensified. But you kind of felt it coming in 2013, but 2015, it, boom, really hit hard. And then 2017, I remember there was a lot of talk about Planned Parenthood. There was a guy who went undercover, and he started filming all these Planned Parenthood executives or employees or whatever they were, literally talking about trafficking the organs of the infants that are slaughtered in abortions. And that intensified the discourse on abortion at that time. And it was like, damn, you know, that was in 2017. And then 2018 comes, okay, 2019, 2020 comes, boom, you're in a new decade. And Texas just in 2021, you know, passes this law against abortion. And that intensifies the conversation on abortion even more. It's like things are just moving so fast, but they're moving so intensely. And the technology, I mean, my goodness, like, for example, you just look at like video games. Take video games as an example. You know, in the late 1990s, Resident Evil horrified people. It scared. Oh, it was so scary. And I remember as a kid, you know, talking to other kids, and they would say, "Oh, Resident Evil." You know, they would play and say, "Oh, it was such a scary game." Now you look at it, and it's not scary anymore. You look at The Exorcist, and that was the scariest movie ever, and it still is a scary film. But I think there are films that came out after The Exorcist that are a little bit more scary than The Exorcist. But you look at The Exorcist now, and it's like, okay, it doesn't really scare you anymore because you've seen it a number of times, and it's an old movie. I don't know. I doubt that The Exorcist has an effect, the same effect on, let's say, Zoomers as it would on boomers. I think boomers were horrified by The Exorcist when they were younger, but if you were to play The Exorcist as Zoomers, it probably wouldn't have the same impact on them. The change is marked by how people react to it, and the oldness of something is definitely indicated by how people have a lack of a reaction to it or a lack of enthusiasm about it. But you look at video games and you see these old video games and they're all pixely and you're like, damn. I remember when I first started playing GoldenEye for N64 and I was like, wow, this game is so awesome. And now I look at it and I'm like, man, that game looks hella boring and nauseating and it's all pixely and looks like crap. You want something more. So you get surprised by something, you get used to it, but then all of a sudden you see an advancement of that same type of hobby, like video games. And that's what you want to go to because it's more clear, it's crisp, it looks better, it feels better, everything about it is better, and you just want more. And that's what that's how the human mind is. You just never stop wanting an advancement of whatever thing that you're into, be it film, be it video games, horror, whatever. And you look at military technology, man, every 10 years, technology changes tremendously. And that's an understatement. And that's just the way human society is. If you look at, for example, the military technology of World War I versus the military technology of World War II, they're almost worlds apart in their advancement. I think in World War I, humans just began to use airplanes in warfare. It was a brand new thing. It was still a relatively new thing in warfare. And by World War II, you have dogfights, and fighting in the air is a standard thing in warfare. But I think what really marks the difference in military technology between World War I and World War II is the elephant in the room, and that is the nuclear bomb. You know, and everybody watched as hundreds of thousands of Japanese were obliterated within a very short amount of time because of a nuclear bomb, two nuclear bombs. But the Germans were interested in this technology. I'm pretty sure the Japanese were interested in this technology, and the Americans just got it first. They got to it before anyone else did. But man, imagine that. World War I, people are using Gatling guns and just starting to get into using airplanes in war, and then people are still also like just running into gunfire. And then World War II, military tactics definitely change, but you have a nuke. I mean, it's like, you got a nuke. You just drop this on a country and hundreds of thousands are dead, just like that. And now the fixation when it comes to military technology is artificial intelligence, AI, using unmanned tanks, unmanned airplanes, you know, airplanes that can fly without human beings, without pilots, tanks that can be moved without a pilot or without people inside maneuvering it. This is the future, and it's going to come to a point, and I've heard this before, but more than likely, it's going to come to a point where hackers are going to be a necessity for war, because you're going to need hackers to hack the AI of the enemy army and then use their own AI against them. Like, things like that could happen in the future. And now it's all about drones. I mean, who has the best drones is going to be the winner of a war, more than likely. Like, just look at, and the whole world watched this demonstrated in Nagorno-Karabakh, in the war between the Azeris and the Armenians. And the Armenian military, the Armenian soldiers in Nagorno-Karabakh, I mean, they were still back in the 1990s as far as their military structure went. They were using, like, crappy Russian aircraft, the SU, whatever. The Azeri Air Force, way more advanced because they're using NATO fighter jets, American fighter jets. The Azeris, they have Israeli military technology, German, they have German military supplies. I believe they use German military trucks, if I'm not mistaken. And they're using drones that were designed by Turkey, but we have to remember that Turkish engineers learned the art of drone making from the United States. But it was those drones, and I'm pretty sure they're called the Hey Mukhtar drone, something like that. That drone is what determined that war. And the Azeris won that war because they had the right technology. The Armenians were using an outdated military structure that just did not work, and they lost the war. But you look at the change, and yeah, I mean, 2010 felt very different from 2015. I mean, in 2010, I was doing martial arts, and we were listening to, like, cheesy rock and roll music while training. I mean, I was listening to Nickelback. I still do sometimes. I think Nickelback was a great band. But now they're considered outdated, and people make fun of them and don't think their music is garbage. I think their music is great. But music has changed tremendously. If you look at the music that's coming out now, it's like, I don't even really listen to it, that much. There are a few good songs here and there, but they come from different countries mainly. But like, yeah, things change, man. And time just gets faster and faster as you get older. It's crazy. But I thought I would do a video just pontificating this, 'cause I've been thinking about this a lot. Anyway. Yeah, I'll tell you one thing that doesn't really change. It's human evil that doesn't change. And human good. You're going to have good. You're going to have evil. But reading this book, almost done with it, Poland's Holocaust, and you read about how Ukrainian fascists were butchering innocent Polish civilians, villagers, peasants, in the most horrific ways you can imagine. And they had no iPhones, they had no Facebook, they had no Instagram, they had no rap, they had no heavy metal, they had none of that stuff that people today may blame or may attribute to all the weird things that happened today. But the reality is that human evil is always going to be here until kingdom come. Just like the French Revolution, as it was recorded in that book by Bodwell. Anyway, you guys just heard some theology. God bless.
What was here now is gone, up and down like everyone. Walk the earth in lonesome cry, but when the sun comes up, when the sun comes up, it will be on your side. It will be on your side. The song of wheels, all demons die. Rays of joy, they multiply. Harmony, you will be my bride. But when the sun comes up, I'll let out last breath. And slumber softly into the dead. You're our fan, prophecy, our destiny. We will not hide when the sun comes up. When the sun comes up, it will be on your side. It will be on our side. Dai da da dam doi da lai da lai dam da le dam da. Hai da da dam doi da lai da lai dam da le dam da. Hai da le dam doi da lai da lai dam da le dam da. Hai da da dam doi dam da le dam lai dam da le dam da. To the death. Hai tara dam doi darai darai dam dale dam da. Wah ho, rai dam dale dam da. Oh hey.